Good morning friends, this is Haseeba. Welcome to today's session on display list and modeling. In yesterday's class, we studied about what do we mean by display list, right? And what are the different OpenGL functions which are used in order to generate the different types of display list. And we also saw a little bit insight about how we have the client and server architecture in our computer graphics. So in today's class, let us start with the current topic, which is display list and modeling. So display list, it can call other display list, right? So as we have seen yesterday, display list is nothing but it is a list which contains the different OpenGL commands which will be stored in a display file. Therefore, we have so many powerful tools for building hierarchical models, right? So that we can have incorporate relationships among the parts of the model, right? Say for example, here I have a simple face modeling system, right? So which has a different types of images, right? So I have two eyes, the one is a left eye, the other is a right eye, right? So we have a nose, we have a mouth, right? So then we have two ears, left ear and right ear. So whatever code I write for left eye, the same thing I can do it for right eye also. That means there is an interdependency among the codes, right? So that is what we mean by one display list you can call other display list, right? So as you can see here, each face has two identical eyes. Each face has two identical eyes, two identical ears, one nose and one mouth, right? And an outline. So we can specify these parts through display list, right? So the display list will be given like this here. So we have written here, right? So I can write the list for I, right? So I'm defining one list, right? So which is for I. So hash define is the keyword what we use, right? So as I have shown, the identifier for the display list is your capital, the name given is EYE, right? So that is I, and the one is the identifier, right? So GN new list, right? So using this new list command, I can create a display list for I. I will write the code how to draw an I, right? So then I will end the list. Similarly, I can also write the code for ears, nose, mouth and other outline, right? So then I'm writing one more display list for defining the face. So hash define face 2, 2 is the identifier. So GN new list of face, right? So inside this display list, which is the face display list, I can call other display list which are I, right? Because inside the face, I have to draw two eyes, right? So two ears and one nose and one mouth, right? So this display list, which is face, it will be calling other display list which are written above here, right? So as you can see here, GN new list face, right? So I'm writing a display list for face. So we are making use of the translate function, right? So that I can position my I in the proper place, right? So I will call the list, right? So by making use of call list, I can have one display list to call the other display list, right? So that is the concept here. One display list can call other display list. So inside the display list of face, I'm calling different types of display list for eyes, for ears, for nose, etc. Right? So GL call list I, right? So first time I'm translating in such a way that I will get a left eye, right? So then I will retranslate the position so that I'll be able to draw the next right eye, right? So the same way I can translate once again my position, and then I will call the list for nose. The same way I can call for ears and mouth, and finally I will end the display list, right? So this GL end list is to end the display list for your face, right? So like this, we can make use of one display list in order to call the other display list. So the next topic is programming event driven input, right? So this event driven input already we have done in our third lab program and fourth lab program, where we were involving the mouse events and our keyboard events, right? So we have used mouse function and keyboard function as the callback function, right? So in our third lab program also, we have used where if I press left button, some action will be taken, right button, right? So it will rotate in some direction, again middle button, right? So the same way here, we are seeing how we can program with our input devices, right? So that is the topic here, programming event-driven input. So the various events can be recognized by the Windows system, and we can write the callback function for all of these events, right? So for keyboard function, we'll be writing keyboard func, right? So for mouse event function, we'll be writing the mouse function. The same way for window event function, we can write it as window func, right? So etc. Like this, for every event we can write the different types of functions, right? So you coming to the next topic, which is using the pointing devices. So pointing devices like mouse, trackball, data tablet, all allow the programmer in order to indicate a position on the display, yes or no, right? So if I make use of my mouse or any other input device, right, so I'll be able to locate the position on the display device. So there are two types of events associated with the pointing device, right? So if I take the mouse, right, so using the mouse I can have two types of event. One is the move event and the other is the mouse event, right? So move event is nothing but I'm just moving the cursor, right? So it is generated when the mouse is moved with one of the button being pressed, right? So I will just hold that particular mouse, right, and I will be moving. So this, if my mouse is moved without a button being pressed, then it's the event is called as the passive move event, right? So active move is if you are holding and then you are pressing with one. This is called as the active move event, right? So if at all simply you are moving the cursor from here to there, right, so then it is called as the passive move event. The next type of event what can be generated by using this mouse is the mouse event, right? So mouse event, it is basically generated when the mouse button is either pressed or released, right? So here I have pressed my right button, then I can see that so many options are displayed, right? So this is called as the mouse event. It is generated when one of the mouse button is either pressed or it is released. So the information which is required for the application program, it includes the button which generated the event, right? So whether it is the left button or whether it is the right button, and what is the state of the button, whether it is the button is pressed or it is released, and what is the position of the cursor, right? So programming this type of mouse events, it involves basically two steps, right? So here we'll be using the mouse callback function. So the mouse callback function should be defined in the form of void my mouse, right? So you will be writing the button, what is the state of the button, which button is pressed, whether it is left button, right button, or the middle button, right? State, whether it is down or whether it is pressed or whether it is released, right? So x comma y is the cursor position or the cursor of that particular mouse, right? So it is written by the programmer by using the function which is my mouse. So I have void my mouse int button int state int x comma int y, right? So if button is equal to left_left_button, that means I am making use of the left button and the state is it is down, that means the left button is pressed, right? So I'm pressing the left button. So if I press the right button, that means I'm pressing the right button. Then exit means come out of the function, right? So like this we can write the mouse callback functions. So this above code, what it will do, it ensure that whenever the left mouse button is pressed down, the execution of the program gets terminated, right? So I'm coming out of the program because I have used the exit function. So next is register the defined mouse callback function in the main function by means of the glut function, right? So in order to call this particular mouse function, we have to make use of a callback function which is called as glut mouse func. Glut mouse func of my mouse, right? So because my function name here is my mouse, so the same function name you have to use and you have to call, right? So this is same as how we call our display function, right? So glut display func we will use, and we will be calling our display function the same way. I can make use of glut mouse function, which is a callback function, and this will in turn call the function my mouse which we have written here, right? So let us take an example. Write an OpenGL program to display a square when a left button is pressed, and we have to exit the program if the right button is pressed, right? So this is very important from your examination point of view. They will ask you simple OpenGL programs like this, right? So we have to write an OpenGL program to display a square, right? So if I press the left button, square should be displayed. If at all I press the right button of the mouse, then it should come out of the program. That means I have to exit from the program, right? So let us see the code now. #include stdio.h stdlib, right? So we have included glut.h. So this is window height and window width, right? So 500 500, right? So you can give here, or directly you can specify 500 500 in your program whenever you are using your GLU or 2D or your viewport, right? So float size is 3. I'm using one variable here, right? So coming to my init function, it's an initialization function. So GL clear color 1.0, 1.0, 1.0. That means I'm setting my background color to be white color, right? So GL viewport it is 00 WH. That means my viewport is what? It is X min, Y min, X max, Y max. So X max, Y max is how much? 500 to 500, right? So I'm setting my viewport, which is 500 to 500. GL matrix mode, GL underscore projection, right? So this you have to call so that you have to select any one of the projections, right? So we have studied different types of projections. So in this program, we are making use of the orthogonal projection. So GL load identity, you are loading the identity matrix, right? So GLU ortho 2D, 0500, 0500. X min, X max, Y min, Y max, right? So your 500 is your window width and window height, right? So GL matrix mode, GL underscore model view, right? So if you make use of this function, then you can view your window, right? So then you have GL color 3F, right? So I have selected RGB color, right? So I'm making use of the red color here. On a white background, I'm drawing a red color square, right? So void draw square, right? So to draw the square, I'm setting the Y value here, right? So Y value is what? It is window height minus Y, right? So based on the input value, right? So whatever you are calling the X and Y, right? So if your window height is 500, so 500 minus that corresponding value will be your current Y value, right? So then to draw the square, I'm making use of GL begin, GL underscore polygon, right? So inside the polygon, so a square has how many vertices? It has 4 vertices, right? So I have defined here size as a 3, right? So float size as a 3, right? So I will be adding for the X value 3 and for the Y value 3. So X is equal to X plus size, right? So again, for one more vertex, X minus a size, Y plus a size, right? So X minus size, Y minus size, X plus size, Y minus size, right? So these are the 4 functions, right, which are basically used to draw the 4 vertices of the square, right? So GL end, it is the corresponding for your GL begin, right? So GL flush, it will force the activation of all the OpenGL functions, right? So this is your draw square function. Then you have the display function. So inside your display function, you are just clearing your buffer, right? So GL clear, GL underscore, color underscore, buffer underscore beta, right? So just to clear the frame buffer, I'm making use of the GL clear function. Then I have written my mouse function, right? So as given in the program, if at all I press the left button, square should be drawn. If at all I press the right button, I should come out of the program, right? So I have written one mouse function as void my mouse int button, int state, int x, int y, right? So these are the parameters which are used in your my mouse function. So if button is equal to left underscore left underscore button and state is down, that means if you are pressing the left button, then you have to draw the square, right? So if at all button is equal to left underscore right button and state is down, if at all you are pressing the right button, then exit of 0. Exit of 0 means you have to come out of the program, right? So this is your main function. You have argc and argv, right? So glut init, initialize the glut, ampersand argc argv, glut init display mode, right? So I'm setting my display mode as RGB and I'm making use of a single buffer here. So glut initialize the window size. So window size is 500 500. So glut create window, I'm creating a window. The name of my window is a square, right? So I'll be calling my display function display, right? So this display function will clear my frame buffer, right? So then I'll be calling the mouse function. So this particular mouse function, so if at all you are pressing the left button, it in turn calls your draw square function here, right? So draw square function will draw the square. So if at all you are pressing the right button, then it will come out of the program, right? So then you have the my initialization function, which is basically used for initialization, and glut main loop, right? So that you can see your output, right? The output will remain on the screen, right? So glut main loop works the same like your get ch. So like this you can write your program in order to handle the mouse events, right? So let us move on to the next type of event, which is keyboard event, right? So using this keyboard event, we have executed the 4th lab program where we were pressing the X and Y characters, right? So that we can increase the size of the cube, or we want to shrink the size of the cube, right? So whether we want to increase or whether we want to decrease, we were making use of the keyboard keys, right? So how to use these keyboard events in our glut program? So keyboard devices are basically those input devices which return the ASCII value to the user program, right? So whenever for every key in the keyboard, right? So every key we have an ASCII value associated with it, right? So the keyboard events are generated when the mouse is in the window and one of the keys is pressed or released, right? So the mouse cursor is inside the window, and whenever you are pressing any key, whether it is pressed or released, right? So at that time, keyboard events will be generated. So the glut supports two functions here. Glut keyboard function It is the callback function for events which are generated by pressing a key. And if let keyboard up a function, it is the callback function for events which are generated by releasing a key, right? So two types of functions you have here. One is glut keyboard function, and one more is glut keyboard up function. Glut keyboard function for all those events which are generated by pressing a key. So whenever you are pressing any key on the keyboard, right? So what are the events which are generated? Like how here I have pressed the enter key, right? So it went on down, it went to the next page, right? The same way, glut keyboard function, it is basically used for all the events which are generated by pressing the key on the keyboard, right? So whereas glut keyboard up function, so this function, glut keyboard up function, it is basically used for all the events which are generated by releasing the key. Okay, so the information which is written to the program, it includes what? It includes ASCII value of the key pressed, right? So whichever key you are pressing, that particular ASCII value of the key pressed and the position, right? So position X comma Y of the cursor, right? So because this is our monitor screen, right? So we can see that I'm moving the cursor, right? So as I move the cursor, the X and Y values, that is the cursor position, will also be moved, right? So and the position X comma Y of the cursor when the key was pressed, right? So programming this keyboard event, again, it has two steps. The first step is I have to write the keyboard callback function, right? So in order to write the keyboard callback function, keyboard callback function is nothing but whenever you are pressing the key, right? So as you have seen here, we have two types of function, keyboard function and keyboard up function, right? So keyboard function, whenever you are pressing the key, keyboard function will be called, that is the callback function. Whenever you are releasing a key, keyboard up function will be called, right? So the keyboard callback function, we will define like this: void my key, unsigned character key and X comma Y, right? So as I have told, you need the key, whichever key you are pressing, and the X and Y position of that particular point, right? So it is written by the programmer like this: to void my key, unsigned character key, int X comma int Y, right? So if at all key is a small q, our key is capital Q, right? So we know that small q or capital Q, we basically use for quitting, right? So whenever I press a small q or capital Q, you have to come out of the program, that is exit of 0, right? So the above code, it ensures that whenever capital Q or small q is pressed, the execution of the program gets terminated, right? So the keyboard callback function, it must be registered in the main function, right? So whenever you are writing any keyboard callback function, you have to register this particular function in the main function by making use of the glut function, right? So the same way how we did for glut mouse function, my mouse, the same way here, we will be using the callback function, which is called as glut keyboard func, right? So glut keyboard func of my key, right? So this particular keyboard function, whatever you have written, my key function, right? So which is, if it comes out of the program when you are pressing small q or capital Q, right? So that particular function you have to register by making use of the glut callback function, which is glut keyboard func, right? So glut keyboard func of my key. So the next type of events what we have is window events. So far we have seen about mouse events and keyboard events. So the last one we'll be seeing about the window event. So a window event, it is occurred when the corner of the window is dragged to a new position, or the size of the window is minimized or maximized by using a mouse, right? So you have seen that if at all I have a window, right? So I can always minimize the size of the window, right? Or else I can also maximize the size of the window. This I can do, right? So by clicking on the minimize maximize button or by dragging it, right? So the information which is written to the program, it includes the height and the width of the newly resized window, right? So because whenever we are doing any window event, right, so the height and width of the window will be changing, right? So that particular input should be stored in your program, right? So programming the window event, it involves again two steps, right? So the first one is we should have a window callback function. So in window callback function, it is defined by using the reshape, right? So already we have seen the use of reshape function, right? So in our lab programs, the same way here, same thing is explained here. So we are using the my reshape function, right? So my reshape, so new size, so GL size integer width, GL size integer height, right? So it is written by the application programmer, right? So let us consider drawing a square as an example. The square of same size must be drawn regardless of the window size, right? So if at all the window is reduced, that is the window is shortened, right? So then that particular square should be fitted inside this particular window size, right? So if at all I make my window bigger, right? So then the square also should grow in size, right? So that is what we mean by reshape, right? So void my reshape. So how to write the function? You have your GL size I, that is your data type, right? So width, GL size I, height, right? So GL is the constant here, right? So GL is the keyword here. GL size I stands for integer, width and height you are giving, right? So then you have GL matrix mode, GL underscore projection. Next, load the identity matrix, right? So GLU ortho 2D, so 0W, 0H, that is 0, W and H, whatever, or resize or whatever size of the window you are specifying. Then matrix mode, GL underscore model view, load identity, right? So then I have the GL viewport, right? So because I have to change my window size. So save the new window size in global variables, which is WW will be equal to new size, right? So which is W and H. Now the window callback function, again, this has to be registered in the main function, right? So every function, whatever you are writing, that has to be registered inside the main function by making use of the callback function, right? So we have used the glut reshape function, which is my reshape, right? So all this, how it works, we have seen in our lab programs, right? So the next is the display function, right? So the display and the idle callback function. So the display callback function, it is specified by the glut by using the glut display function of my display, right? So it is basically invoked when the glut determines that the window should be redisplayed. Whenever you want your window should be redisplayed, right? So you have to make use of the display function, right? Because any display or anything, whatever I want to do in our graphics program, right? I cannot do it directly, right? I have to write a separate display function for that, and I have to call back that particular display function by using the glut display func, right? So it is invoked when glut determines that the window should be redisplayed. So if you want to re-execute, re-execution of the display function, it can be done by making use of glut post redisplay, right? So repeatedly, if you want to execute your display function, then you can call your callback function, which is glut post redisplay. Then we have one more function, which is idle callback, right? So this idle callback you are doing whenever you have no events, right? So when there are no other events, then you can specify by making use of the glut idle callback function, right? So glut idle func of my idle. So this you are calling an idle function because you don't have any events. So next topic we have is window management. So how to manage multiple windows, that is what we'll be seeing here. So glut also supports multiple windows of a given window, right? So far we have seen that we can have only a single window, right? But if our OpenGL also provides to have multiple windows, right? So we can also create a second top level window as follows. So glut create window, second window, right? So glut create window, first window will be there, right? So inside that window, I can have one more window, right? So this particular glut create window, it will return the window ID. So this returned integer value, it allows us to select this window as the current window, right? So once you have created a second window, you have to select that particular window, right? So in order to select that particular window, you have to set it, right? So you are making use of the glut set window ID, right? So if at all you are selecting this window, say for example I have two windows here, right? So I want to select this window, or I want to select this window, means then I can create the glut create window, second window, right? So two windows I have. So whichever window I want to select, that particular window I have to set, right? So to do that, I'll be using the glut set window ID. So the second window, it can have different properties from the other window, right? So and by invoking the glut init display mode before the glut create window, I can make use of my second window, right? Or I can set the different properties for my second window. So next topic, what we'll be seeing is the menus, right? So as you know, menu are an important feature of any application program, right? So I can have a drop down menu, right? So if at all I click on something, right? So I have a drop down menu here, say edit, this is a drop down menu, right? So by making use of the menus, I can provide different features, right? So OpenGL provides a feature called as the pop-up menus, using which we can have sophisticated interactive applications, right? So whenever you want to make your an application, right, interactive, then you should have your menus, right? So menu creation, it involves the following steps. The first step is we have to define the actions corresponding to each entry in the menu, right? So whatever are my entries in the menu, right? Say for example, add sticky note. If I want to write something, right? So then I have to click on this particular button, right? So first I have to define the action. Select the tool, it will help me to select the tool. Hand tool will do the job, its own job, right? So the same way we have to define the actions corresponding to each entry in the menu, right? So like if I click on the file, this is my menu. Open means it will open the file, right? So save as, close, properties, right? So print, exit, like that. right? So you have to define the actions. Then we have to link the menu to a corresponding mouse button, right? So if I go for file, right? So if I'm clicking the left button, then I'm getting this option, right? So here, if I want to do something, I'm clicking the right button like that, right? So you have to associate different types of mouse buttons, right? So for every menu. Then what we have to do, the third step is we have to register a callback function for each entry in the menu. Every entry in the menu has to be registered in the main function so that we can do it using the callback function, right? So that glut create menu is the function which registers the callback function to registers the callback function, which is the demo menu, right? So I'll be writing one function, right? So which is menu, demo menu, right? So this I have to register by making use of the glut create menu. The function glut add menu entry, it is basically used to add the entry in the menu whose name is passed in the first argument, and the second argument will be the identifier which is passed to the callback when the entry is selected, right? So let us see that here. So here what we are doing is we are writing one menu function, right? So the name of the menu function is a demo menu. Demo menu int id, right? So switch id. So whichever identifier you are passing there, right? So based on the identifier, the case will be executed, right? So case one is exit. Case two is you are setting some size, right? So case three like that. And you want this to be redisplayed. That means whenever I'm clicking on that particular menu, I want it to be displayed, right? So that is why I'll be calling the function glut post redisplay. So glut also supports the creation of hierarchical menus, right? So we can also have hierarchical menus like this, right? So one menu is linked to another menu, right? So you can see here how we are adding the menu entry. So I'm creating one menu, right? So glut create menu, size menu, right? So inside this size menu, I can add the menu entry as, I can increase the size of the square, I can decrease the size of the square, right? So I can create a menu which is top menu, I can add one more menu entry, right? So for quit, resize, right? So then glut right button, right? So this menu function, right? So we have seen in our program, which is for filling the polygon, right? So there for the right button, we had created a menu, right? So that we can fill the polygon, we can come out of the program, right? So all those things, some three options we had included, right? So there I have explained how to make use of the menu option, right? So we can add the menu entry, we can create the main menu, and I can also have one menu which is linked to the another menu, right? So here the main menu what we had designed was for quit and resize, right? So this has a sub menu, right? So resize has a sub menu which is for increasing the size of the square or decreasing the size of the square, right? So like this we can create the hierarchical menus. So the next topic what we'll be discussing is about picking, right? So picking is what? It is the logical input operation that allows the user to identify an object on the display, right? So which object you want to select on the display is what we mean by picking, right? So the action of picking, it basically uses the pointing device, but the information will be returned to the application program is the identifier of an object, right? So whichever object you are picking, right? So that ID of that particular object will be returned to the program, right? So it is difficult to implement picking in modern system because of graphics pipeline architecture, right? So therefore converting from location on the display to the corresponding primitive is not a direct calculation, right? So there are at least three ways to deal with this difficulty, right? So picking is a little bit difficult, right? So but we can overcome by making use of three different ways, right? So the first way is I can have a selection for picking, right? So selection means it involves adjusting the clipping region. So which part you want to select, right? So this is what we mean by picking, right? So I'm selecting from here to here, right? So this much particular part I want to pick, right? So it involves adjusting the clipping region and the viewport such that we can keep track of which primitive lies in a small clipping region and are rendered into a region near the cursor, right? So whichever part of the portion you want to select, right? Or you want to clip, right? So that you can do it by making use of the select option, right? So these primitives will be sent into a list which is called as the hit list, which can be examined later by the program, right? So I can also have the bounding boxes or extent, right? So in this approach, what we are doing is the extent of an object is the smallest rectangle which is aligned with the coordinate axis that contains the object, right? So whichever object, all right? So bounding box means what is your range, that is what we mean, right? So the extent of an object, it is the smallest rectangle from where to here, from here to here you are extending, right? So this is called as the bounding box, right? So till here you are selecting. So for 2D, it is relatively easy to determine the rectangle in street coordinates that corresponds to a rectangle point in the object coordinate, right? So, but for three-dimensional objects, the bounding box is right parallel piped. If the application program maintains simple data structure to relate the objects and the bounding boxes, approximate picking can be done with an application program, right? So what they mean is, say for example, for a 2D, two-dimensional object, if I want to select that, this is my bounding box, right? It is very easy, right? And the screen coordinates, whatever we have, I can directly convert it into the object coordinates, right? But for three-dimensional object, it is a little bit difficult, right? So in the third way, how we can do picking is by usage of the back buffer and extra rendering, right? So whenever we make use of the double buffering, then it will have the two color buffers, right? Front buffer and back buffer, right? So you have seen that in so many lab programs we have used double buffering, right? So whenever we have, say, I had a color cube, right? So which I want to display, every face of the cube I want to display with the different colors, right? So at that time I'll go for double buffering, right? So because from one buffer it has to select one color and it has to display for one face of the cube. Again, for the next face of the cube, you are selecting one more color, right? So the contents present in the front buffer will be displayed, whereas the contents present in the back buffer will not be displayed, right? So we can use the back buffer for rendering the scene, right? So like this, we can just shift the buffers from the front buffer to the back buffer like this. This is what we mean by usage of the back buffer and extra rendering, right? So picking can be performed in four steps that are initiated by the user-defined pick function, right? So you can do picking by using the four steps. What is the first step? First step is we draw the objects into the back buffer with the pick color. We get the position of the mouse using the mouse callback, right? So we can draw the objects into the back buffer with the pick colors. We can get the position of the mouse using the mouse callback function. We can also make use of the GN read pixels in order to find the color at the position in the frame buffer corresponding to the mouse position. We can also search the table of colors to find the object which is corresponding to the color red, right? So like this, we can make use of the four steps in order to perform picking, right? So what we are doing in the first step, we are drawing the objects into the back buffer with the pick color, right? So whichever color you have picked, by making use of the pick color, you are drawing the objects in the back buffer. Then you are trying to get the position of the mouse using the mouse callback function. Then you can make use of the read pixel in order to select the color from the frame buffer, right? And then based on the corresponding mouse position. Then you will be searching the table of the colors in order to find the object which is corresponding to the color red, right? So like this, you can follow these steps in order to perform picking, right? So the last topic, what we'll be discussing here is picking and selection mode. So the difficulty in implementing picking is that we cannot go backward directly from the position of the mouse to the primitives, right? So OpenGL, it provides a selection mode in order to do the picking, right? So picking can be efficiently implemented in OpenGL by using the GL_select function, right? So the GL render mode is basically used to choose the select mode by passing GL_select. So when we enter the selection mode and when we are rendering the scene, each primitive within the clipping value, it generates a message called as hit, right? So hit means you have selected it, right? And it is stored in a buffer which is called as the name stack, right? So whenever you are selecting any object, right? So that particular object, right? So or the primitives of that particular object will be selected, right? So and it will generate a message which is called as the hit, right? And that entire scene or entire area, whichever you have selected, it will be stored in a buffer which is called as the name stack. So the following functions are basically used in the selection mode. So void gl select buffer, gl size I n, glu int buffer. So it specifies the array buffer of size n in which to place the selection data, right? So like this, we can have gl init names, which is basically used to initialize the name stack, right? So gl push name, it pushes the name on the name stack. Pop name pops the top name on the name stack. Load name replaces the top of the name stack with the name. Right, so OpenGL allows us to set the clipping volume for picking using the GLU pick matrix. Right, so you can use the GLU pick matrix in order to perform the picking. Right, so GLU pick matrix has parameters x comma y, right, w comma h, and star vp. Right, so it creates a projection matrix for picking that restricts a drawing to a w x h area. Right, so that means you are picking the x value from window to height area, and you are centered at x comma y in the window coordinates within the viewport, right? So you can see here the first diagram, it talks about the normal window and the display, right? So this is the normal window and you have the display here, right? So whereas the second option, you can see that you are displaying after picking, right? So here just the objects are displayed, right? But here I have selected what object I want to display, right? So this is the place where I have selected the object whichever I want to display, right? So this is called as picking, right? So we have picked this and then we have projected this here, right? So this is how you are, you can make use of your picking matrix, right? So there is a normal window and there is an image on the display, and we can also see that there is a, we can also see the cursor with a small box around it indicating that the area in which the primitive is rendered, right? So it shows window and display. The figure B shows the window and the display after the window has been changed by using the GLU pick matrix, right? So the following code, it provides the implementation of the picking process, right? So we have the code here, hash include blood.h. We have the display function. Inside the display function, I'm clearing my frame buffers, right? I'm calling one function which is called as draw objects, right? So, and I have GL flush. So draw object, it is basically used to select, right? So which particular object you are selecting, right? So mode GL underscore select, you are loading that name, right? So color 3F rectangle, right? So again, if mode is equal to GL underscore select, one more, you are loading the name, right? So setting the color, again, you have the GL rect function, right? So hash define void mouse, right? So we have GLU init name buffer of size, right? So just go through the code. This code is basically used to select a particular object and you are just displaying that particular object by making use of your GLU pick matrix function. Right. So the last topic what we have here is a simple CAD program, right? So you know what is CAD? Computer aided design, right? So where we can create different types of objects, right? So we are creating different types of polygons here. So applications like interactive painting, designing of mechanical parts and creating characters for game are all examples of your CAD. So CAD basically allows the use of multiple windows and viewports in order to display a variety of information, right? So you can also make use of isometric projections, you can do orthogonal perspective projections, right? So everything you can do in your CAD application. So we can also have the ability to create, delete and save the user defined objects. So multiple modes of operation we can have by using the menus, keyboard and mouse, right? So consider the polygon modeling CAD program which supports the following operation, right? So simple CAD program we are discussing here, which is basically creation of polygon, deletion of polygon, selection and movement of the polygon, right? So this particular polygon modeling program, it is this given in your textbook, right? So the textbook which you have to refer for your fifth module is Interactive Computer Graphics by Edward Ancheon, right? So it is not there in your Pauline Baker textbook, right? So one more textbook you have to refer for your fifth module, which is your Edward Ancheon, right? So in this we can see the code for how we can create a polygon, how we can delete and how we can have the selection and movement of the polygon, right? So then we have building interactive models. So using OpenGL we can develop a program where we can do insertion, manipulation, deletion. And also, we can build a program which is quite interactive by using the concept of instancing and display list, right? So already we have seen how we can make use of the display list so that I can draw a human face which has face, right? So inside that, I have eyes, ears, nose, everything, right? In the same way, I can also make use of the instance method, right? So consider an interior design application which has items like chairs, tables, and other household items. So these items, they are basically called as the basic building blocks of the application, right? So each occurrence of these basic items, we call it as an instance, right? So occurrence of a table is an instance, occurrence of a chair is an instance, occurrence of other household items is an instance. So whenever the instance of the building blocks are created by the user using the application program, the object is stored into an array called as the instance table, right? So for every instance which is stored in my scene, right? So for every instance, we have an instance table. Right, so we reserve the type to specify that the object, type O to specify that the object no longer, type 0 to specify that the object no longer exists, right? So if I have to delete that particular instance, then the type of that object, particular object will be 0. Now suppose the user has indicated through a menu that he wishes to eliminate an object and use the mouse to locate the object, right? So whenever you want to eliminate a particular object, what we have to do, first the program can has to search that particular object, right? So the program can now search the instance table till it finds that particular object. Say I have a chair in my scene, I want to delete the chair, right? So first I have to select in my program where I have the chair, right? So that is my instance. So first you have to search your program in order to find the instance table, right? So once you have find the object as specified in the bounding box, then what we have to do, since I have to delete that particular object, I have to set the type of that particular object to 0. So whenever I set the type of the object to 0, that means I am trying to delete that particular object, right? So hence next time when the display process goes through the instance table, the object will not be displayed and thereby it appears that the object has been deleted, right? So in order to do this, the above strategy, that is by making use of instance and instance table, we can do so, right? So but we can also make use of better data structures in order to implement the instance table by using the linked list instead of arrays, right? So far we were using instance table, right? So table is nothing but the collection of rows and columns, right? So which is our array. So we can use a linked list, right, compared to arrays, right? Because it will have a more realistic views. Let us stop here, right? So in the next session we'll consider the next topic, which is animating the interactive programs. Thank you.